Hello everyone, this is Leslie, your host. Welcome to Les's Lounge, where everything and anything is talked about because, well, it's a lounge. Today I have a couple stories for you from the Reddit reads. One has to do with an entitled family. Another one has to do with an entitled parent. Y'all need to watch out, I'm telling ya. So let's get into the stories. Fiance's family bans me from our home after he dies. I'm going to preface this by saying that brevity is not my strong point, sorry. It was hard to know what to include since there's a lot of backstory. If nothing else, writing this felt good because it was a very traumatic time, and getting it off my chest is helpful. Hopefully no one thinks I'm the entitled one. My fiance, N, died very unexpectedly in 2016 at the age of 35. I was 26 at the time. We lived together in a house on a few acres. I'd lived there for a couple of years and he had lived there most of his life. N's grandfather built the house, and when his grandparents died, the house was willed to their six children. One of whom was N's mother. When N's mother died, her share is willed to N and his two siblings, so N was a partial owner of the home. His aunt R also lived there. She was mentally unstable in many ways I won't get into, except to say that she was a serious hoarder. Consequently, the house was in disrepair. Honestly, it was not fit to be lived in and could have easily been condemned, but it was a rough time. Please spare your judgment if you can. N and I were in the process of getting an apartment when he died. Since N and R were the only partial owners living there, they paid all the property taxes and for repairs, etc. I contributed too after I moved in. It's not like N and I were just squatting there or something. A couple months before N died, R had some health issues that resulted in her being hospitalized and then moving into an apartment. That's when the entitled family, N's aunts, uncles, and cousins, swooped in and started demanding that we move out so they could sell the property. Okay, fine. We were planning on moving anyway. They were really unrealistic about the timeline though. At one point they insisted that we were low income. All we needed to do was contact the government, they didn't know what department, and they'd just give us a small house and some land. That's how out of touch with reality these people were. They'd just show up in the house whenever they wanted to, which I guess legally was their right, but it's also pretty rude and entitled to just come into someone's home on a regular basis without even speaking to them while you're there, much less letting them know beforehand. Anyway, when N died, they were unabashedly elated. 2 days after he died, I was at the house collecting some of my things when I got a text from his sister, who is an angel, so we'll call her AS, saying that they'd message his out-of-state uncle's wife asking her to message AS about me because God forbid anyone be direct. Apparently, they wanted me banned from the property immediately. We'd been living in sin, and now that N was gone, I had no reason or right to be there. I was devastated. At that point, I wanted to take everything he'd ever touched and scoop it up and hold it close to me forever. I couldn't bear the thought of not being able to have anything of his. As an afterthought, I realized all of my stuff was also still there. Luckily, AS stuck up for me and said I could be there as long as I wanted. She lives across the country though, so she couldn't do much to enforce it. The most egregious display of disgusting entitlement slash general assholiness happened a couple days later. I was at the house, frantically trying to load up the car with the things that made up the life that N and I shared together, which was taxing both physically and emotionally. I was crying when N's cousin, EC, appeared in our bedroom. EC, smiling like I'm an old friend she just ran into each other at Costco. Hey, isn't this crazy? N died so suddenly. He was fine a few days ago. Me, through tears. Yeah, it was very unexpected. EC laughing. I know. Well, at least we can sell this dump now. It's then that I hear people talking, laughing in the next room. Apparently EC had brought her teenage daughter and several daughter's friends to gawk at the house, our home, where we lived and loved, was being openly mocked in zero regard for my feelings. EC, so when do you think you'll be gone? Me, I'm not sure. I'd like to get as much of N's stuff as possible, and AS asked me to get some of their mom's things. EC frowning. Well, I guess I'll have to talk to AS about that. Their mom is the reason this place is run down, you know. Laughing again. I don't see why AS would want any of this garbage. Note that this is blatantly false, as the house had been in pristine condition until N's mother died, and R's hoarding worsened to the point that N could not keep up with it. Also, there were plenty of keepsakes and heirlooms that were not at all garbage. I'm sort of dumbfounded by this whole exchange and way too emotionally drained to deal with it, so I just get back to what I was doing. Later that night, EC's sister messaged me asking what I'd done with R's box of plastic horses. R wanted them back immediately. Of course, I had not taken it. Why would I want a box of plastic horses? Hint, I would not. I elected not to reply. After that, they got more aggressive about me not being there because I was a plastic horse thief. N was an artist by trade, and they started just throwing away all of his drawings and taking some of the more valuable figurines he had. The last day I was there, my mom went with me. After getting the last of what I could, I just wanted to walk around the house one last time and sort of say goodbye to the place we'd spent so much time together in, a place I'd never be again. Of course, the family showed up, and my mom tried to calmly explain that I would be out soon and would not return. She tried to appeal to their sense of humanity by explaining how traumatized I was from his death and how I just needed this for some semblance of closure. But his aunt got in her face and lectured her about how Anne was in hell and I'd be going there too. Then my mom, who somehow managed not to knock her teeth out, reminded her that AS had told me I could be there. The aunt responded by calling the police to have me forcibly removed. We left before the police arrived, and now that's my final memory of the place where the most amazing man I've ever known taught me how to love. Now this story is quite sad. I do feel for the youngin', but sad to say, it happens a lot. I know in my family, that is par for the course. That's why I just disowned my family, most of them anyway, because of situations like this. It's really rough, and I really feel sorry for her, and I do hope she finds happiness. Ian thinks we're a daycare. Well, her child is now gone. I used to work in a small chain of bookstores / stationery shops. We'd sell books, pens, paper, and so on. It was a quirky little store, straight out of a romantic love novella, or a Stephen King book if you prefer. This happened a few years ago, and I reconstruct it from my memory. While trying to be as accurate as possible, I can't guarantee it. EM, entitled Mother, walks into the store with LG, little girl. It's rather early in the morning. EM looks around, asks me if I could watch her child. Me, oh no, I'm terrible with children, sorry. EM tells me that it's not for that long and I shouldn't be such a fuss about it. I still politely refuse. It's not my job to watch children. I'm afraid to do something wrong. What happens? Ian leaves the store. Who do I find hidden in the corner? LG, who seems to be rather shy and fearful. This happened back in a time before everyone had smartphones. The kid obviously didn't have a mobile on it. I suspected the mother also wouldn't. Wasn't too surprised that LG didn't know the number of their landline. I sigh. What are you going to do? If something happens to that kid while being in my store, and you being the only present employee, you're going to have a bad time. Me, hey girl, what's your name? LG tells me her name. Me, I give her my name. LG, happy like only kids can be if they think they did something smart or they knew something. My surname is, and she gave me her surname. Now this rang a bell. I had a good customer with the same surname. It turns out that it's her dad. I didn't get paid enough to babysit. In fact, I didn't even get paid enough to do my normal work. I call her dad at his workplace since we have the number saved in our system. The call went along these lines. Me. Hi, ND, for nice dad. Here's me from bookstore XY. ND. Oh, hi, OP, how's it going? I don't remember having any open orders. Me. Yeah, look. Listen. Do you have a daughter? ND, confused. Yes. Why do you ask? Me. What's her name? I just wanted to ensure it's really her dad and not just a stupid coincidence. If I think now about it, LG told me it's her dad, so I don't know why I wasn't sure. ND apologizes for EM's behavior and tells me he's going to pick up LG as soon as possible. While waiting for ND, I picked up one of our sale books, box with damaged books that we tried to sell with huge discounts before throwing away. A picture book from Disney. LG tries to read a little, I read a little. ND arrives, LG runs to him and hugs him, crying that mommy was mean to her. ND sues her and thanks me for babysitting her. He gives me a bottle of wine and buys something small from the store. ND. If EM shows up again, could you not tell her that I picked up LG? Me. What? Why? ND. If you don't feel like it, you don't need to. It's rather complicated, and you already did so much for us. ND leaves. In the evening, EM shows up. Just to point out, she dropped LG at about 9 o'clock. It was 5:45. EM. Where's my daughter? Me. Already chugged about half the bottle of wine, and thus a little boozed. Your what? EM. My daughter. I dropped her here in this store, and you were here. Me. Way too drunk for work, but I already decided to go for another job or homeless. Both would have been better. Your what? EM was on edge. Thus, I did what I thought was the smartest thing to do. Me. A guy came into the store and picked her up. He seemed nice, gave me some wine for her. At this point, I expected her to explode or attack me, but she just left the store. A few weeks pass, and ND and LG come to the store. Both happy to see me. ND asked me if I got a few minutes. An excuse not to work? Obviously, I took the time for customer service. Gave LG the same book we read the last time and had a talk with ND. EM and ND were in the middle of a divorce when EM dropped LG at our store. One of the reasons ND wanted a divorce was that EM wasn't nice to LG. Now in my country, as a male, it's rather hard to get custody of your child, no matter what. LG wanted to be with ND, but that doesn't matter. EM dropping LG on our store was a gift of the heavens. ND took LG to his sister overnight. EM pretended that LG was sleeping at one of her friends. ND wanted to call them just to ensure that LG is fine. EM didn't want that. LG's friend didn't know where LG was. EM claimed she dropped LG at LG's friend's. ND faked panic and involved the police. EM insisted that LG's friend kidnapped LG. Police asked ND and EM separately, and ND told the police what happened. EM still insisted on her dropping LG at LG's friend's. ND had proof of it being otherwise, since he already called the police when he dropped LG at his sister's house. Now, in court, ND apparently said something like, EM can have all she wants, even my wine collection. I just want to be with my daughter. EM, knowing that ND didn't have any money, left and had some quite expensive wines agreed. Daughter ended up with ND, mother paying alimony. What EM didn't know, ND was replacing his wine collection before the divorce with the cheapest wines he could find at different discounters, gifting away the expensive ones. He knew that EM either is going to take everything from him or will break his wine collection. We both laugh. I gifted the book to LG, who seemed very happy. When EM dropped her, she was shy, seemed small, and now she had such a big smile on her face and was curious for everything. She could read much better than a few weeks ago. She seemed like a bird taking off to fly towards the sun. I absolutely hated my job, but situations like these make me a little bit nostalgic. Somehow I miss direct interactions with customers. On the other hand, I don't. I obviously don't. Well, folks, I don't know if we can call this an entitled mom or a total B-word, I don't see how you can just deny where your child is. There was no concern whatsoever for her kid. She shouldn't have custody of that child. Oy. Well, folks, that's all the time we have for the stories. I hope you liked them. If you liked any part of it, please comment, like, and subscribe. And if you feel so inclined to leave a tip in the tip jar, the link will be in the description. I hope everybody has a great day, a great night, and we'll talk later.